to the winter preliminaries for Europe. I'm joined on the desk by Sottl and D2. And like you just saw in that advert there, the Fireside Gatherings is where players are playing at today and yesterday. So be sure to get involved in those and see some of your favorite players compete. Sottl, how are you doing?
I'm doing very good, man. Like you said, this is a very exciting tournament to be a part of. It's a very new thing from Hearthstone. As you said, it's being played at numerous Fireside Gatherings all the way around Europe. So exciting, brave tournament format, but I think it's been a big success so far.
D2, we just saw, well, just cast a game with you. We have some two new players. How did you feel about the last game overall?
I think it was pretty good. Lucario, obviously, a bit of a shakier performance than he had yesterday. But obviously, what we saw from Pokrovac, I think, was really just really well played by him overall. I was really impressed with a lot of his plays there. So, yeah, looking forward to see him in the European Championships and looking forward to this next match, honestly.
So this next match is Nick Slay versus Bunny Hopper. You know a little bit about Nick Slay. We couldn't find anything on the internet. He was a bit of a mysterious challenger.
Very good. All right. I'll give you a 7 on that one. But yeah, he was a difficult guy to track down. He doesn't have too much of a storied tournament history, but we were able to talk to him a little bit before this game. Turns out he's got his qualification points through ladder, which is no great surprise. He doesn't seem to be too much of a tournament player so far. Picking up a 99 finish and a 60 finish to qualify here, picking up 10 points in total. He says his love of Hearthstone kind of fluctuates with the meta a little bit. Kind of drops out of Hearthstone when he doesn't like the way the meta is going, say during the Undertaker days, he said he wasn't a huge fan of. But he's very much committed to it right now, but says that he's looking to possibly study engineering in the near future. But maybe a successful run here might convince him that a professional esports career isn't such a terrible idea.
And what about Bunny Hopper, D2?
I got a couple notes here. He's 23 years old, doing his PhD at the University of Oslo. He's coming from Germany, so going to be playing from Norway here, but obviously from Germany, which Nick Slay, I believe, might be from there as well. And played some small tournaments before, started playing seriously in tournaments since. One thing that's interesting is he started playing in October of 2014, and that's when I was at BlizzCon, so it's crazy to see these players get so good in such a small amount of time and make it to this point, just showing how much the game is growing and how many new players there are that are super strong.
And these guys have mirrored lineups, maybe not mirrored decks, but the bans are different. Bunny Hopper has had his Warrior band, and Nick Slay has had his Warlock band. Now, you've got some interesting statistics about these classes.
Yeah, this mirrored lineup that we see here is almost a perfect closed capsule interpretation of the meta of this tournament. Warlock, Druid, Paladin are the three most common classes, and they're being seen in both lineups. And the top two bans are Warrior and Warlock, which are the two bans that we've seen so far.
All right, game number one about to happen. Bunny Hopper versus Nick Slay, and we have the Secret Paladin going against the Warrior, and I see a fierce monkey there.
I love how you said the Warrior, because this is quite interesting right here. Looks like it's probably Control Warrior, but, well, it could be anything, honestly, looking at this.
Reno question mark?
You know what? I feel like, just as my personal opinion, but I don't think that Reno Warrior is the strongest, and okay. I feel like if Nick Slay's made it this far, I don't think he's bringing the Reno Warriors.
I have seen Patron Warriors run Fierce Monkey instead of Shredders. I don't know whether that's a good decision. I'm not a Patron player. So that could be the archetype he's gone for. But then, however, if he fears, if he feels like he needs some more mid-range pressure in the Control Warrior, he could definitely run both of those cards.
Yeah, absolutely. I've seen Fierce Monkey included in Patron occasionally, as you said. Sometimes in place of Shredder, sometimes even in place of Frothing, because Frothing is kind of a harder card to get value out of these days. But we're still a little bit of a mystery as to what this Warrior deck is.
There's the Whirlwind, though, and Whirlwind isn't typically used in Control Warrior, so looking more and more like it's going to be that Patron Warrior here. So a pretty decent matchup for Nick Slay, but as we all know, I mean, the Secret Paladin just can make anything happen sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely. He doesn't get any weapons in his opening hand, and Unstable Ghoul is another very powerful card to have open early as the Patron Warrior. And it interacts so well with Shielded Minibot. Generally, the way that they would like to deal that one extra damage is to follow it up with Muster, but obviously that's not a thing you can do when there's an Unstable Ghoul on the board. But his hand is not looking too terrible. He has a couple of answers. Acolyte to play out generally early, and Bunnyhopper's hand, few minions to play, but not the devastating opening curve that Secret Paladin can come up with.
I kind of like these kind of matches, right? Neither side has a crazy opening. They're kind of okay. It's not a disaster for either player either. I think in this kind of matchup, in this kind of situation, you really see the player skill come out.
I think Bunnyhopper probably has the better hand. He has a curve, he has a Coghammer, he has a Blessing of Kings as well. And with that Haunted Creeper, he might get some value from the 1-1s once that's been popped open. But on the other hand, Nick Slay, like you said, has a Whirlwind available to him, which interacts well with that, and an Execute if he needs to deal with anything big. Acolyte Pain for card draw, so they've got kind of a mixed match of hands, but I kind of feel like Bunnyhopper has the edge in that respect.
Right. Nick Slay, as of right now, has to decide whether he needs to react to this Haunted Creeper in any way. He could choose to slam it to set up a Whirlwind slightly later on, but slam is a very valuable card, especially when he's lacking a lot of options in his hand that he'd quite like the Fiery War Axe, Death Spite, etc. So no great surprise. It's only one power on board, just chooses to armor up pass.
I do like the pace which these players are playing. I mean, maybe some people in chat are thinking, you know, Resident Sleeper or whatever, but they're really taking their time and making sure they make the right play. Bunnyhopper had a lot of stuff to think about that last turn. You were talking about the Unstable Ghoul. In that situation, Knife Juggler probably better, but Bunnyhopper's saying, you know, I want to take my chance, want to go with this Haunted Creeper, and if you have a Fire War Axe, then this is much better against it. Yep. Against the Slam, it's much better as well. So I like these players kind of taking their time, and in the end, Bunnyhopper made the right move considering what Nixley had.
There's a lot on the line here. You should be patient. You know, this is qualification for the season's championship, more prize money, more recognition within your communities as well. So these guys are playing for a lot. This is not just a best of five in a community tournament. This is the big shot, right?
Right. Although both of these guys are obviously very accomplished players in their own right, you don't get this far without being that. You don't finish top 100 on ladder at the end of the season without being a very strong Hearthstone player. It's probably fair to say this is one of the biggest games of Hearthstone they have played in their career. So no great surprise they're taking their time, thinking it out. And as D2 very, very succinctly illustrated, playing that Knife Juggler after the Haunted Creeper has made Nick Slay have to use essentially slam for 3 mana instead of 2.
Exactly. So Bunnyhopper here has a couple of options. I imagine he just plops down that Muster for Battle. Obviously, it's a bit weak in something like a Deathbite, but in that instance, you still get a lot of damage off and maybe just get Blessing of Kings for that extra 4 damage as well.
I don't know, I quite like Coghammer maybe. It just makes things really awkward for him. You know, nice. Shielded Spider, can't pop it open to clear the 1-1s. And if he doesn't have an answer to the Spider, Blessing of Kings can follow up.
Exactly. This shielded minion on... This has Divine Shield and Death Rattle. So what are the chances that, even though it's one minion on board, what are the chances your board is clear next turn? Looking at his curve in hand, Blessing of Kings is the only thing he has to do that's particularly proactive next turn. So I really like this Coghammer just banking the Blessing of Kings for the following turn.
It's like a mini Tyrion. He's got a Death Rattle, he's got a Divine Shield, he's got Taunt. I mean, it's all you ever want in a card, right? Maybe we should put that in some other cards in the deck. Or maybe that's a bit too strong. But for Nixlake, has a bit of a decision here. I mean, what do you even do in this situation? Do you overcommit to try to kill this because of something like Blessing of Kings that could come next turn? Or do you play it so it looks like he's going to go with a slow play?
Yeah, I think this is the sort of situation that comes up in Hearthstone where you shut your eyes and you say, I don't really think I can beat Blessing of Kings in this situation, so therefore that card doesn't exist, and I'm going to make the best play assuming that he doesn't have it.
I do like the Armorsmith, though, because now Bunnyhopper has a tough decision on his side, so Nixley kind of creating a bit of tension here, right?
Yes.
Well, what do you do? If you're Bunnyhopper, you could go, you know, 5 damage to the face, which is very powerful, or you could try to get rid of this Armorsmith before it is able to do anything special here, but in either case, Nixley can go with that Inner Rage plus Execute plus Whirlwind here, so I like what Nixley has done, playing it slow, realizing that he can deal with this a bit later.
I like going face here, because you force him to pop open the shield, and you force him to use extra cards, and I hit an ooh from Sottle there as the Battle Rage comes down. This is an opportunity to draw some cards at least.
Yeah, it is and it isn't. As an avid Patron Warrior player since, you know, way back in the day, I was one of the very, very first people playing any sort of viable build of Patron Warrior, and when you have that much experience with a deck, you tend to get excited when you draw the card Battle Rage. Unfortunately, I think he's kind of obligated to use his mana elsewhere here, and he's going to hope that those minions are able to stick and that he can follow up with a Battle Rage on a later turn.
Yeah, Inner Rage is a really powerful card here, but he's going to use it particularly because he's drawn a second one, and he really just wants to have these minions on the board, and really annoying for Bunnyhopper to deal with right at this moment.
Look how many spells he had to use just to clear up a spider. Like, that 1-2 just became such a threat. He just had to throw answers at it, multiple answers, and now even one spider sticks around.
And it's interesting, something we haven't really touched on, there's double Abusive Sergeant in this Paladin deck from Bunny Hopper. Not a card that you see all the time, but it's personally a card that I'm a really big fan of in Secret Paladin. My go-to Secret Paladin list plays all the buff cards. I play Argent Squires as well instead of Secret Keepers. Mm-hmm. Abusive Sergeant, Blessing of Kings, Keeper of Older Man. Sometimes even sneak an egg in there just for a bit of flavor. But yeah, Abusive Sergeant is just such a great meta call when the meta is full of other decks that are competitive on the board early, like Zoo. Because in a battle between those two sorts of decks, if one of you has access to Abusive Sergeant and the other one doesn't, you're in such a serious disadvantage.
I don't know. I have the greediest Secret Paladin list there is. It's all of the mid-range minions to throw Rag in there as well. Screw it. This sort of Divine Favor as well. You know, just get those cards. But looks like Bunny Hopper has kind of that in mind with that Divine Favor. And having seen the Whirlwind the previous turn, he feels safe enough to go with this really all-in play right now with all of these one-health minions.
And Nyx Slayer draws a Grim Patron, so if he didn't have to invest the Whirlwind and all those resources into that Spider, he would have had a lovely Patron board going into this turn. But now he's battle raging for some cards. What will he fight? Another Grim Patron.
It's a very risky play.
And the monkey!
If he had drawn Whirlwind there, that would have really paid off. But now he looks like he's going to go for the Paladin Shredder. It's still a reasonable play. I mean, maybe you kind of shut certain things down by, you know, using that Lotha, for instance. But I think this is reasonable.
Yeah, he had the other option there, which was just to go for the sort of
two patron.
Small patron generation turn. But one of them would be immediately challenged by one of the two ones that would be left on the board after the trade. So he's only banking on 1/3/3 living, essentially, which does require an answer from your opponent, but not much of one.
This is Secret Paladin, though, right? They always have the older one on time, you know, just taking it out right away. So I can see why Nyx Slayer would be a bit hesitant to go for that. And this is kind of an atypical game, right? I mean, Bunny Hopper's just killing his opponent with 1/1s.
It doesn't happen usually. Doesn't it? Patron usually has so many whirlwind effects, they can deal with all these 1/1s, but Nyx Slayer's just in a frustrating situation.
I just want to point out, we've referred to this as Secret Paladin several times. Have we seen a single Secret or Secret Keeper?
I would expect there to be. I mean, we don't really need Secret Keeper.
That's true.
We're also looking at the Abusive Sergeants, right? So there's a very strong chance this is just an aggro Paladin deck. We're also looking at Divine Favor, which is a card that is sometimes cut from Secret Paladin.
So what have we seen so far? We've seen Coghammer, we've seen Mustafar Battle. We've seen the Spider.
I mean, no secrets.
I feel like if it's aggro Paladin, there's a bit more charging minions.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, that's sort of the old-fashioned style of aggro Paladin, but this deck, I can't quite remember off the top of my head that came up with it, but he gave it the name of Zoo Paladin.
Right.
Or it's essentially trying to play with that sort of strategy. So, I mean, it's up in the air. This could very well, you know, we could just see Mysterious Challenger top deck next turn, and then we all look very stupid, but yeah, there's
only you, only you.
Only me, yeah, okay, that's fine.
But if you think how many secrets are in the deck, plus the challenges, and the secret keepers that are traditionally in Secret Paladin, we haven't seen any of them at all. Like, not one secret, not one keeper, not one challenger. I think this is aggro Paladin, or Zoo Paladin, as you'd like to coin it.
Well, at the very least, we're all a bit confused, so think about what Nyx Slayer is thinking right now.
Yeah, that's true. And he has to win this game, so yeah, he must be very confused at this point.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to know whether the thought process has even occurred to him, because he hasn't really seen any cards that, as you pointed out, he hasn't really seen too many cards that, okay, that would never be in Secret Paladin.
Right.
Yeah, the Abusive Sergeant is a little bit weird, so whether the idea has even occurred to him that he's not playing against Secret Paladin is debatable. But that Battle Rage may just dig him his own grave this turn. Unless he follows it up with a Loatheb to lock out the Divine Favor, this could be a ton of resources being gained from Bunny Hopper on the comeback turn.
Yeah, so ironically, he doesn't want to draw anything good and just default to the Loatheb afterward, right?
Yeah.
All right, so let's see what he goes with. He might just ping off this Divine Shield and go for that Battle Rage. I feel like that's really the only play. Maybe he's making the next level read that his opponent does have Divine Favor. It's been stuck in his hand the entire time. I mean, realistically, at this point, it's Divine Favor, Tyrion, or Rag, I would say.
One thing we will know for sure, hopefully, is if Divine Favor does go off, we will get a better idea of what we're seeing from Bunny Hopper. But like you said, no secrets yet. And if it is aggro Paladin, and Nyx Slayer's been thinking about Secret Paladin, nice little mind game there with the deck, because it's got very similar cards.
Oh, is he going to armor up? Wow.
Wow.
So is he never going to play this Battle Rage?
That is crazy. This is the kind of thing that like happens to you when you're streaming. You're like, okay, nice snipe, dude. Like, I'm sat here with one card in my hand that's Divine Favor, and you don't cast your Battle Rage. But in this situation, that's just an incredible read from Nyxlay.
He can still play an 8-mana Arcane Intellect if he wants to.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, 8-mana, 3-card draw. What are those 3 cards? I don't even know at this point. I guess Nourish. 8-mana Nourish. Here we go.
The one thing is, Bunny Hopper has nothing else to do other than Divine Favor. And there's a Finley.
You're making that face at me. Okay, one of us is going to look dumb at this point. I guess it's looking like it's going to be me right now. But Nyxlay still has a pretty good chance here. I mean, if you're playing as the patron, typically that's a good matchup against Zoo. If this is Zoo Paladin, then maybe Nyxlay can still take this.
Yeah, Grommash coming into hand. There's a lot of damage now being lined up between those two Deathbite swings, but he has a little way to go, I think, before he can think about being aggressive. He's definitely under threat of death on the swing back, so he's going to have to think about how he wants to address this board. And now, having seen that Divine Favor used, he's going to feel probably a little bit more more loose about using that Battle Rage.
One thing right. to note as well is if he leaves anything on board, the aggression can just continue. You know, that Blessing of Kings is going to be a nightmare for him. And the Pile of the Tread is such a sticky minion, he's probably going to have something on board by the end of this, and then the damage is going to start coming.
It's also worth pointing out that both executes have been used, I believe, one on the previous turn and one on the massive Haunted Creeper that was built up with the Blessing of Kings. So he doesn't have too many ways to fight back against this board apart from weapons, which, as I believe we saw in the previous game, sometimes Warrior, in the previous game we saw against Rogue in the last series, sometimes Warriors just end up taking too much damage by swinging into stuff with the weapons.
That's why I like playing this Dr. Boom out, right? Because if you don't have any more answers, you might as well get your questions on the board to help deal with some big minions that could come on the board right here. So even though Nyxlay was kind of hemming and hawing about whether he should go for it, I think it was the right play in the end.
So Blessing of Kings would add 4 to this board. That's a total of 9. He can add a Consecration to that for 11. Doesn't have enough mana on top of that to play Finley and get a hero power that he can use. So he is a little bit short this turn, but definitely stacking up on the damage here. And again, I'd like think the double Consecration is more indicative of an aggressive Paladin deck than it is a Secret Paladin deck.
I keep rubbing it in. I don't like this.
I don't know if I would have liked it.
I know how to milk my victories, okay, D2?
All right, well, looks like it is going to be that double Consecrate to clear out this board from Nyxlay, and going to be the Finley Murgleton afterward. I think he's going to go for as aggressive a hero power as possible
absolutely.
In this situation.
Instant Hunter if it comes up. Doesn't get it.
Fire Blast, yeah. I need that damage. I was thinking of a different line of play to that. Maybe Blessing of Kings, the Shredder hit face, use a Consecrate maybe to soak up some Boom Bots and clear in the low feb and force him to use his Dr. Boom to clear the Shredder. It's a bit more risky, but it put him down so low.
Right.
And if you are an aggro deck, be aggressive.
That Whirlwind is a really nice draw, although we may just choose to use the Grom as a removal tool here. He definitely wants to be, he's low enough with his health that he definitely wants to be thinking about clearing the board every turn. Mm-hmm. Take away Keeper of Older Man, take away Blessing of Kings as a form of burst damage.
He's going to go for the Grim Patron, it seems like.
He can full clear this way too still, right? Patron, right. Whirlwind, Fiery War Axe. Yeah, this seems totally reasonable as well.
And he still gets the heat to use his armor up as well, which is very important seeing the Fire Blast coming out of his opponent. He knows of the situation now. Bunny Hopper is all in. Nyxlay needs to stay alive.
This might be an opportunity for Nyxlay to sustain. He might stabilize now if Bunny Hopper can't have anything stick to the board. But then again, his health is not the best of resources at this point. Another Divine Favor.
Still an Arcane Intellect though, right?
Yeah, that's not bad for free mana.
Oh, this is very interesting.
So like he wants to keep something on board now because he may not have charge minions. This may be the more zoo-orientated aggro paladin.
And again, as I pointed out earlier, both executes are used, and I'm sure Bunny Hopper has taken note of that.
Right.
So this Pilot Shredder is big enough to force itself to be dealt with. And it means that Nyxlay has to do it hard style.
Yeah, probably going to be the Armorsmith with the Grom here. Going to throw the 3-2 in as well. And is there going to be a minion that can allow this Grim Patron to spawn another one?
That will definitely be a huge swing on the board if it is a smaller minion that will replicate a Patron. Otherwise, Nyxlay will have to, if a 3-2 comes out, Fairy Dragon or something, Nyxlay will have to seriously consider whether he just throws away his last Patron to get rid of it.
Although we have seen, this is the second Blessing of Kings. So after this, there's the Pyromancer, obviously. I think I would like to see him using space there because he would have still been at 8 health. I mean, as you've been talking about this entire time, this is a Zoo-style Paladin. It's not really a burst style.
I think the problem with that is, though, that his Grom is a 10-1 right now, so leaving up a Wild Pyromancer on the board.
No, I mean, use your face to kill it rather than use the weapon.
Okay, yeah, sure.
and he would have kept the patron alive. Again, still no charge minions, so Bunny Hopper has to keep things on board to be able to finish him off. And the one thing Nyx Slave will be able to do is press that hero power, start to get some health, and while the Armorsmith is up, he'll be able to get even more health. So this may be Nyx Slave's game to take.
Absolutely. Mage Hero Power coming in very, very useful here to get rid of that 10-1 Grom, but he has definitely left his grip on this board. And as you were pointing out, D2, earlier, generally when you think of an aggro Paladin deck, it has South Sea Deckhands, Arcane Golems, Wolf Riders, etc. Those are the kind of cards that he would love to be drawing in this situation, or at least for the previous two or three turns. And his style of deck being more zoo orientated, whereas minions on the board being leveraged with buffs. Since the Patron Warrior has now got a grip on this game, it's much, much harder for him to push through those last points of damage.
Exactly, and that's why we obviously saw the Mage Hero Power coming in here. Gonna be this buff on the Armorsmith. Nyx Slave continuing to play very defensive, could have maybe thought about going for a couple patrons there instead and leaving up that Leper Gnome. But again, Nyx Slave really kind of concerned with what Bunny Hopper can
that's
do.
That's not a great draw for Bunny Hopper. A Death Wipe will clear it up, and the patron in hand, he's gonna be able to generate at least two patrons. So now I kind of feel like Nyx Slave is back in this game.
Yeah, I think we're in a pretty realistic state where that Muster for Battle just may not get played because it doesn't feel good this turn straight into the Whirlwind. On the following turn, there is going to be Grim Patrons on the board. So again, a board full of 1-1s as the Paladin player does not feel like the thing you want. So Muster for Battle, widely regarded as one of the strongest cards in the game, but one of the strongest early game cards in the game. It can be a bit of a detriment in the late game if you draw it instead of a powerful minion.
Exactly. And I do like the ping on this this cruel Taskmaster. It means that Nyx Slave has to take two more damage here in order to clear off the shield and mini bot, and that's probably going to be the play here. But I still feel like Nyx Slave is in the prime position to take this game unless we see something crazy out of Bunny Hopper. We've seen double Consecrate, so even if there's somehow some crazy equality Consecrate tech in this deck, it's not going to be coming out here because of those. The Consecrate are coming out already, and Nyx Slave has the ability to go with his mana crystals are a bit funny here.
yeah.
So a bit of a bug there. Looked like he had three, but it said five. So yeah, is able to play everything out and armor up, which is what he wants here, obviously, in this situation.
The monkey was great as well. Another defensive minion, protects his patrons. This deck from Bunny Hopper has told probably Nyx Slave at this point that he relies on board to be able to do anything. And he keeps clearing the board. He keeps, and this doesn't feel great as well.
It's just one
health off him. And ping, like this is kind of desperation plays coming from Bunny Hopper. Another weapon is picked up with a death rattle through the Whirlwind, so more patrons can be spawned very soon.
Yeah, Nyx Slave realizing right now that he can just go and take the damage right here, realizing that, I mean, Bunny Hopper, that's probably not burst in his hand at all since his talent. And that's going to be the concede. Bunny Hopper goes down. Nyx Slave takes the game. A huge moment, I want to add, because not only did he get the win, but he now knows almost everything about that deck.
Right, exactly. You heard us going through our thought process about what the mystery of that deck was. Had he just not drawn his secrets and his secret keepers and his challenge yet, or was it a more aggressive Paladin? And we now see that he has full information. He's seen 20-ish cards in that deck, if not more. You know, both Divine Favors were
exactly
cast. So,
and what's really good about that victory for Nyx Slave as well is he was behind. You know, things were looking great for Bunny Hopper, and he managed to crawl back and get a victory where things were looking pretty bleak at one point. And that's, I think, as a player, is a big confidence boost. You know, you were down, things weren't looking great, and all of a sudden you get this win. And now, like you said, you have all this information about that surprise deck, I would call it, because it's not a conventional paladin we see.
I think it's something you're quite used to as a Patron Warrior player in particular. Against those board-focused decks, the Zoos, the Secret Paladins, etc., you kind of accept being behind for a while, and then suddenly you just make your one turn where you push, you make patrons, you clear the board, etc., and then you can stabilize from 7 HP, 5 HP, whatever. You can just build up the armor overall with Armorsmith. So if he's an experienced Patron player, he probably felt quite comfortable in that game, even as he started to drop low.
Yeah, we had some suggestions for him. Maybe we thought that certain plays in here weren't completely optimal, but overall that entire game, considering he had no idea what was going on with his opponent, maybe he's seen that deck on ladder before, but I think overall he played maybe a bit defensive at the end, but I mean, he just navigated the game to perfection toward the end, and especially in the beginning, was able to take some of the damage off the board and was able to come away with a win. And now Nyx Slave is looking really good.
I mean, now he knows what this deck can do. He can plan against it more. Before, like us, we were like, Is this Secret Paladin? Right. Like, maybe he had a game plan in mind to play against Secret Paladin specifically, but now with all the information, he can plan his next moves a bit more carefully. No surprises anymore. I know what this Paladin can do. And we're going into game number two. Nick Slade taking a 1-0 lead.
There's a Secret Paladin.
Yeah, no fights about it. No fights about this one, D2. This is a Secret Paladin from Nick Slade. Competitive spirit, dead giveaway, but Bunny Hopper choosing to stick with the Paladin choice himself. And this is an interesting point that I've seen discussed quite a lot since Conquest format has come in. Something I've heard a lot of experienced pros say is that they try and get an advantage because they have noticed a tendency for less experienced players to stick with the same deck more than they should.
Right.
So that's something we're seeing here. You know, it's whether it's a matter of pride, it's just like, no, this deck is good. Like, I was right to bring this deck to this tournament. I'm going to show you that right now. I'm going to come back and I'm going to win this next game. But it's something that I've definitely heard pro players talk about exploiting in sort of open tournament formats. People tend to stick with the same deck after they lost.
So again, those reads. Right. Like, this player's not that well known. Maybe he's nervous. Maybe he'll just stick to it. And then I can make maybe a counter from my lineup against it.
Exactly.
And we saw it from Lakari. He stuck with his Control Warrior for two games in a row, and in the end he was just like, oh, I better switch to Zoo. Well, things are not looking good.
To be fair, typically the only time where it's strategically correct to differ from what you brought in the first game is when you lost an unfavored matchup. Or
sure.
lost a favored matchup, excuse
sure.
me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because otherwise what you're thinking going into the match was doesn't actually change
right.
as far as what you're trying to win with. So we are getting into this game, and I was going to joke before that maybe Nick Slay was kind of just going to punk me here and have only one secret in his entire deck, but we see the repentance as well. Going to go start off with that Haunted Creeper match by his opponent. Let's see how this game kind of, you know, fills out here. And Nick Slay doesn't really have a turn three play. He has obviously, you know, a coin one into a two play, but Bunny Hopper looking pretty good right here with that muster for battle and many options going forward.
Yeah, absolutely. And just in terms of secrets that you want to draw early, repentance is definitely not high in that list. It can fight for board early in very tempo focused matchups because you can just enable a nice trade if you've cast Muster, if you have, for example, Haunted Creeper tokens on the board that we're about to see. It can be a nice bit of tempo early, but generally, if you are going to get secrets in your opening hand, you would rather have the Noble Sacks, the Avengers, etc.
Do you feel that Repentance has any good targets against Bunny Hopper? Because we haven't seen, like, Dr. Boom or anything yet. We've only just seen kind of those mid-range and early-game minions.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to ever be a huge blowout, but as I said, just sometimes the tempo of reducing, say, a Shredder or a Keeper of Alderman that we see in hands, especially with this board state, where there's just a bunch of 1-1s ready waiting to attack. Sometimes that little tempo gain is enough to just swing the state of the board and give you an advantage.
Really bad situation here from Nick Slade. Doesn't pick up any minion here to play on turn three. Picks up that Dr. Boom instead. And now he's probably just going to go for that repentance. If nothing else, to just bluff, you know, some other secret here. I mean, it probably goes off on that Pile of Shredder, which is not the greatest target at all.
The interesting thing is, you know, as you said, he might play repentance here and his thinking will be to try and bluff other secrets. What then is your sequence of attacks to bluff the maximum amount of secrets?
Right, I guess you could try to buff something like Avenge here. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you can basically bluff anything, really. I mean, sometimes even when you're playing secrets that are actually do more than repentance
yeah,
in this situation,
yeah, yeah.
you
yeah.
still bluff the other one yeah. to make your opponent fall into it. So I think in this situation, Bunny Hopper, it could be anything to him, I think.
Yeah, he might be afraid to give him an Avenge at this point on his 2-2, but it looks like he's just going to go for anywhere, see what happens. Doesn't see anything happen at all, so he may think Competitive Spirit, Repentance are probably the two most likely ones. But like you said earlier, Sottl, if he plays Keeper of Alderman now, that would be excellent for Repentance. If he plays Shredder, it's not great, but then
right.
again, we haven't seen any kind of big threats in Bunny Hopper's deck yet.
Yeah, so I think his initial plan there was attack the 1-1. If Avenge triggers, he probably just would have played the Curve Keeper of Alderman just to reduce the Avenge mini-bot back down to a 3-3. Now, having seen that secret not happen, I'm a little surprised that Keeper is being played for that exact reason that you just mentioned. It looks like he's thinking twice about it right now. He has ruled out a lot of the secrets. We're looking at Competitive Spirit. And
Repentance.
And Repentance is the only two possibilities. We know it's Repentance.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you. I mean, if it's Competitive Spirit, a 3-3, are you too sad about that?
Right.
You know. And here in the situation, you're perfectly fine with your Pile of Shredder. It comes back. Both your minions come back. And this is basically the essence of this deck, right? It's a Zoo Paladin.
One thing could have been considered, and if he was making a read on Competitive Spirit, the 3-3 buff wouldn't kill the Keeper.
Right.
So he was a 50-50 for him, right?
Sure.
And
yeah, yeah.
I think no, Shredder would have stuck around because of the Death Rattle. So I think overall Shredder was the safer play, even if it was competitive spirit, because you get a minion after.
Yeah, in 50-50 situations like that where it is just a straight coin flip and you don't have any information, any reads, any tells to help you out, just evaluate the situation and go, okay, I'm going to play into one of these, which is worse for me? And then you go with the one that's better for you if you get it wrong. So obviously he goes for the, he gets the Shredder hit by Repentance, and that's a better situation.
Ooh, 1-1 comes out of there. And I think in this situation, I kind of like Nyxslay's position because they're going back and forth, right? They're clearing each other's minions, and then Nyxslay is going to kind of curve higher than his opponent here, and Bunny Hopper, basically, he's going to try to curve into something like, you know, basically the Divine Favor, and he's not going to get any value potentially.
Very, very true, but I think a little bit of exploitation this turn of knowledge that Consecration in Secret right. Paladin is very rare these days.
That is true.
Most people 50-50. Are playing.
That knife juggler is going to get taken out quite nicely. But like you said, Nyxslay will eventually get to the situation where he starts dropping the power plays. And we haven't seen any from Bunny Hopper in his deck just yet. So that could be something Bunny Hopper will struggle with. We haven't seen the quality or anything either. So if Nyxslay can clear this board, Bunny Hopper might not be able to come back.
Do you play the Avenge here, Tuttle?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't get used for the next couple of turns. Those turns seem to be fairly well set with the Challenger into Boom Curve.
Right. I mean, but if it doesn't go off, then it
doesn't. You miss the value from the Challenger, yeah.
But then there's a Knife Juggler on the board. It's probably going to get taken out.
Right.
So in the end, I think his thinking was that this Knife Juggler is a big enough threat that my opponent's going to want to kill it, and I get double value out of the Avenges.
Absolutely. And we are seeing the situation that you both elaborated on a little bit earlier, where he's just running out of kind of big threats to be able to compete with the huge bombs that are kind of going to come out from Nyxslay over the next couple of turns.
There is Dr. Boom, though. That's a pretty good pickup in this situation.
It is.
And it's probably the best card to pick up right now, even though he's not going to be able to play it until next turn. That's much better than something like a Divine Favor, for instance.
What do you like here? Steady Shot is the aggro direction, right? But what else could he do? Armor up? I don't feel that. Totem, how do you feel about Totem?
Interesting. I was going to say, like, Hunter isn't exactly perfect here because your opponent's at 25. You're not quite at that stage of the game yet. So you wouldn't have minded picking up a board control hero power, but I don't really think I qualify Shaman in that category in this situation. So I think I may have just defaulted to the Hunter in that situation and just accepted my position as the aggressive deck in the matchup.
Yeah. I mean, Shaman's kind of weird, right? There's so many options available
right.
because of, you know, you can draw one of four. With this spell damage totem, he could go for, you know, extra consecrate. With something like a taunt totem, he could really be annoying for his opponent, especially if there's an avenge in it. Okay, there's no avenge. What am I talking about? I keep thinking this is Secret Paladin. But, there's just different options available, and he probably felt like the Hunter Hero power didn't affect the board enough, and considering he's playing Zoo, that's probably what played into his decision here.
One thing that kind of crossed my mind with Shaman pick is that Nyxslay's hero power 1-1s don't kill the Shaman totems straight off. So if he does need to keep board to win this game, the 2 health might be enough to maybe drop an Argus on it and maybe get some value from that.
Sure, Argus is a good point. Keeper of Older Man is definitely a consideration. Obviously, Shaman decks, historically, before they made the switch to Face Shaman, they're leveraging things like Flame Tongue Totem and other buffs to make their totems do things. And that's what I kind of worry about with other classes when they pick the Shaman totems. It's, you know, can they get usage out of them?
Well, he does have the double abusive, though.
He does have double abusive. He does have Keeper. And as Nick pointed out, like, Defender of Argus would be a perfectly sensible card in this deck, even though I don't think we've seen it yet. So, okay, you guys have convinced me. Shaman seems reasonable.
This is a really big moment, though, by the way, because Bunny Hopper saw the Repentance before. Very, very unlikely to be the second Repentance with 4 secrets going up. So just plays out that Dr. Boom. A lot of times it really messes you up because you can't play the Dr. Boom on curve. But here, Nyxslay is facing a huge board.
He is indeed. And we saw he drew the Tyrion Fordring on the previous turn. So he did have that perfect Paladin straight at his disposal. 6 into Dr. Boom this turn, into Tyrion on the following turn. But does he feel like he needs to make a more reactive play to this board? And if so, can he even do that? I mean, is there really any other play except Dr. Boom this turn? I guess Blessing of Kings 14 face is a turn?
Yeah, Blessing of Kings 14 face, play the Monster for Battle, Lightstress's face too. I mean, that's a lot of damage to face.
It demands a trade from your opponent, right?
Yeah, the problem is that there's a pretty easy trade once you get that Keeper of Aldemar.
Yeah.
I don't know if I like trading. I think I prefer trading here because you have the Tyrion follow-up, right? So you have the better minions going forward. But there is also the case that Nyxslay probably doesn't have a great idea of what late game friends but
look at the grimace on Nick Slay's face.
I don't want to do it. This is just the feeling that Paladin gives you, though. You want to make the aggressive play. You want to establish your dominance, but there's so many punishes: Blessing of Kings, Coghammer, Keeper of Older Man. All those things
all
can come
in his
down.
Hand. All in his hand.
Every single one of them. So yeah, as much as chat might be screaming "Smort, go face!" right now, I think the disciplined play of the trade is absolutely
correct. Oh, look at Nick Slay. He feels so good. He's nodding right now. He's like, "Yes, thank you, thank you. I made that play. I didn't turn my 10-9 into a 3-3."
Right.
So he feels validated by his play here. Let's see where these boom bots land. I mean, let's say in this crazy world where Bunny Hopper hits the boom bot and all the boom bots die and he has to take 10 damage, that would be pretty problematic, I would say.
The one thing that I like.
Okay, yeah, gotta go with that first, just in case. Just in case something crazy happens, he went with the boom bot first.
But Nick Slay's in a situation now that the boom bots are probably going to be cleared this turn, unless one sticks around a Bunny Hopper's, and he has Tyrion. You know, the 6-6 to taunt, the Vine Shield, the weapon going forward with 24 health. He could probably just keep fighting for board until he, say, draws another challenger. But the one thing that does make Tyrion a little awkward is double muster. You want that. Unless he pops a Tyrion, he doesn't pop the Tyrion open.
Right. And just going back to the previous turn, you know, you said Nick Slay obviously had a very validated look on his face when the Keeper of Older Man came down. I don't want to oversell that read. You know, it's a fairly common thing at this level. You know, you'll expect Keeper of Older Man, but again, we saw in the previous game an extremely strong read on Divine Favor. So this is obviously a player that knows what's going on with his opponent's hand. He's not just thinking about his plays. He's putting himself in his opponent's shoes. And he's making strong decisions because of it.
Ooh, goes face here. Finally says, okay, I can actually go face here. Realizes there's 3 1-1s on the board. One of those is going to trade in anyway, so it might not make too much of a difference.
Right.
Bunny Hopper leading off with his other 1-1 first, the Special Spider. And hits for 4.
Wow. It's
absolutely massive. And the stink face comes out from Nick Slay. So yeah, gonna be the Cog Hammer. What does it land on? Pretty important here. It lands on the good minion, I would say. In fact,
I mean, either way, right? Because you know,
true.
I think this is better. But even if you get the 3-1, you still have that annoying Divine Shield taunted spell power totem in the way. So
I would like to just see the clear of this Dr. Boom, just in case something crazy happens. I suppose it's really hard for something crazy to happen because of that Lotheb. But yeah, Nick Slay, you can see him kind of frustrated with the situation. Bunny Hopper doesn't have much in his hand, but Coghammer can be worth 2 cards.
Although he can clear the shield, he can Blessing of Kings for 9. I know it doesn't feel great. And he'll keep his Dr. Boom alive. But you know, double muster's not great either, because he wants to get as much value as he can from the Ashbringer. And the Secret Keeper is not a minion you want to find. But I think Nick Slay can stay in the game still. Definitely if he draws some Shredders and stuff, things will look better for him going forward.
Yeah, that Boombot hitting Tyrion for 4, though, was huge on just so many levels. You know, simple terms, we removed the Tyrion. That's fantastic. But it also opened up the 3-3 to the favorable trade from the 3-4 behind that. And as you pointed out the previous turn, it popped the Tyrion, gave the Ashbringer, and now suddenly this double muster is sat in hand thinking, well, I kind of need to get value out of my Ashbringer before I cast this card now.
Right. I'm liking the Dr. Boom, by the way, with the sparkles on it. It's like, that's not buffed at all. It's like, no, it was nerfed and then buffed and then back to normal. But the Lepronome coming out of the hand here and just so much pressure on. And yeah, with basically that, the Annoyatron Wrath of Air totem getting in the way here. I don't know what Nick Slay can do. I think he might just be dead.
These Coghammers have had a major impact on this game,
absolutely.
I think, at this point, because if he didn't have Coghammers, he could just start clearing and trading and sticking to the plan that if I keep this board cleared up, I can probably win. But back-to-back Coghammers, even if they're landing on favorable targets, unfavorable, it doesn't matter. The taunts are stopping him from getting any leverage here, and he has to throw away the Ashbringer.
Yeah.
Well, you need to at this point.
Unless Bunny Hopper attacks with the Lotheb first, which I doubt he's going to do, this game is over.
Yeah, I mean, the optimal attack here for Lethal is with the Lepronome, since it gets the 2 damage anyway, but he doesn't even need to do that. He can attack
even
with the
one. The Keeper of Alderman. So
Right.
So that's going to be it. Bunny Hopper takes game number 2. We have a tie series.
Yeah, the Secret Paladin falls to the unconventional Paladin, one we haven't seen a lot of. We've seen Murloc Paladin this week, weekend already. So it's nice to see Paladin get another kind of a different style of deck in the mix.
Also, I thought you were about to say it's nice to see Paladin get another win. No.
Yeah, it's interesting. Paladin is the third pick class overall in the tournament based on yesterday's statistics. Been picked 105 times by players. But we're seeing that's not all Secret Paladin. We've seen the Anyfin Paladins. We're seeing the more Zoo-style Paladin now. But I guess he's validated there by his choice to stick with the deck. We spoke about it a little bit at length at the start, but paid out, ties the series back up at 1-1, and he can just move forward.
I think one indicator, we were looking at some of the stats that we've seen from this tournament, and you talked about it a lot, but one thing that really shows how strong Paladin has been is the third most banned and also the second highest win rate. We saw something, basically Warrior, for instance, highest banned, but way down the list on win rate, because if players are able to beat it, then they don't need to ban it. But even when it's not banned, Paladin's still winning.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's very, very meta-defining, because the highest win rate deck in the tournament right now is Mage. And the reason for that is Freeze Mages and Tempo Mages being very, very successful against Secret Paladin. So it's a very meta-defining deck at the moment, and people are reacting to it, either figuring out whether they want to bring it, whether they want to bring up a lineup to defeat it, whether they want to ban it. But Secret Paladin is just definitely one of those decks that shapes your considerations for your tournament lineup.
Not anything Paladin, no?
It's not quite there yet, right? And one thing I'd like to point out as well is this unconventional Paladin might go to top 8. So could this be like another type of Paladin that can be successful in the metagame? We'll have to find out.
I mean, it has been successful. I wish I could recall off the top of my head. It might be Game King who came up with this originally. If you guys at home know, feel free to tweet using hashtag HCT. Maybe we can get the information pulled up on stream. But I think it's Game King who originated this Zoo-style Paladin list. It has been around for a little while. And one of our friends from the UK, someone who you will see on the Americas preliminaries cast next week, Raven, he's used it to win a Strivewire Cup. So it's a deck that's been around a little bit and obviously very, very successful for Bunny Hopper in this tournament.
All right, we're seeing the Warlock deck come up here for Bunny Hopper. Looks like it's going to be more of a Zoo style. Remember, Bunny Hopper banned out the Warrior from... Excuse me. Nyx Light banned out the Warrior from Bunny Hopper, and Bunny Hopper banned out the Warlock. So now we're seeing those other decks that weren't banned by their opponents in this situation. So Nyxlay obviously not too worried about that Warlock. Feels like he has a better chance to defeat it. Let's see if he can do so.
And this is a matchup we're going to see quite commonly on ladder. You know, Zoo has picked up a lot of popularity. Reno Jackson lock kind of had the Warlock spot at the start of League. But as more Druids showed up, Zoo started to come back. The more aggressive Zoo as well, not the mid-range Demon Zoo that we were used to before League of Explorers.
Yeah, Nyxlay is taking a little moment here, but not too many decisions. I'm pretty sure he's going to summon this girl this turn.
Right. I think passing right here would be a bit of a misplay, we could say.
But again, this is something that I've actually deliberately forced into my tournament play as well, which is turn one of every game, just take a moment. Think about what you know about the matchup. What are you trying to do? What cards do you need? What cards do you have to look out for? What are the key turns? When do you have to really flip the switch, etc.? Just evaluate all your matchup knowledge in one go. And again, no decisions to be made there that turn from Nyxlay. Obviously, it was Secret Keeper pass, but he just took his time.
Another thing to consider as well, if you take time deciding on, well, no decisions were made here, you just play a one drop. If you take time and make your opponent think you're making decisions, he may be thinking, what other stuff does he have in his hand that he can play? Can you play a secret this turn? Did he just go for the keep? Like, there's a lot of mind games you can play on the first turn.
I think it's the exact opposite could be true as well. If you take a lot of time here when you have an obvious thing to do, later on, when you have, when there was something obvious that you could have done, something that comes to mind yesterday was when Oskaka decided not to play his Dread Corsair after playing the Fire Warrex early on. That seemed like something that was pretty obvious. He's going to go for the Fire Warrex, and then maybe your opponent starts thinking, oh, the reason why it took so long to do that was because he has that coin Dread Corsair. But if you take long for every single turn, then you have no idea what's going on. You don't know why they're taking long. You know, it could be anything.
So, going back to the game, the Voidwalker has come down to protect, curved it out into the shielded minibot here. 1-2, pretty solid so far, but Coghammer, looks like it might get some value next turn, but he's really lacking that proactive play. If a good Coghammer opportunity presents itself next turn, then that's great. Otherwise, it's going to look more like a secret hero power kind of turn, unless there is, of course, the glorious top deck muster for battle that we all know and love.
Absolutely. I think it could have a pretty good value here. If Bunny Hopper goes for Knife Juggler into the coin abusive, looks like it's just going to be the abusive. but it could have been a situation where Nyx Light could have used that Cog Hammer to take out the Knife Juggler and used the mini bot to take out the Void Walker. But Bunnyhopper going to go for a more resilient board here instead of for Knife Juggler and feature turns.
Yep. Knife Juggler can definitely... I like this line because he can use the Creeper to get additional knives on the following turn to help fight for board. And then his Knife Juggler is only exposed to the board for one turn before he can get that devastating implosion follow-up on turn four.
Yeah, Haunted Creeper is usually a good bet here just because you want to be able to get some knives flying around from the Death Rattle effect. And it's a sticky minion. It's not something Nyx Slayer is going to be able to deal with straight away. So yeah, I do like this Haunted Creeper sticking around.
Yeah, absolutely. The Divine Shield being re-granted to the mini-bot does make the Knife Juggler a little bit more awkward. And that Power Overwhelming draw definitely increases the temptation of getting a Nerubian Egg in play.
Yeah, Bunnyhopper going for a bit of a... You know, a greedy play here, getting that out. He could have maybe gone for the Knife Juggler right here and started maybe flinging knives. Does he pop open his Creeper right now? It will get more power on the board, but then it kind of gives Nyx Slayer the opportunity to start clearing that stuff out. We also see the Keeper of Oldemon in hand, so yeah, and it ends up working out pretty well for Bunnyhopper not trading in here.
That's a good draw. Get the Shredder. Don't have to use the Secret of Oldemon if you don't want to. And I think with the Knife Juggler as well, while the Cog Hammer sits on the board, you just don't want the Cog Hammer to hit your Knife Juggler. You want to get more out of it, especially in a matchup when knife juggles can kill tokens, dudes, has a lot of value.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. Shredder draw on turn four, obviously very powerful, but I agree with you, D2. I think skipping over attacking was better that turn because you just would have had the Cog Hammer go into one of the 1-1s and the 2-2 would have gone into another one of the 1-1s, and your Power Overwhelming then on the egg is just, it's not really doing it. It's doing one damage for a Power Overwhelming. So seems you can get a little bit more value just by waiting. As we've mentioned, it seems like Piloted Shredder is just the power play here. I don't quite see the merit in a Keeper of Alderman, but as we've mentioned, Nyx Slayer is being consistent. He's taking his time, he's thinking over his options. I think the previous turn was played quite quickly with the Cog Hammer, just because it was so obviously apparently strong, but...
Yeah, I think he was 90% leaning toward that Piloted Shredder, but he was just considering what Bunnyhopper did the prior turn and really wondering what kind of attacks he wanted to make this turn. And now he's kind of made it so Bunnyhopper has to have something to take out this shielding mini-bot, and there's no crazy Knife Juggler shenanigans going off right now.
Yep, so there's still that final charge of the Cog Hammer, as you mentioned last turn, Nick.
How much is this going to roll for?
We've seen a lot of twos. We've seen a lot of twos today.
We really have, yeah. It's been rolling two a ton, but as you mentioned, Nick, he's kind of holding on to those jugglers. He doesn't want them just to get immediately smacked down by the Cog Hammer, but he needed a bit more board presence than those two imps this turn, I think.
He needed a push, right? And a 3-2 is definitely something that can do it. I mean, I know it just dies to the Cog Hammer, but you want to be able to keep the Paladin at bay, and he's just not doing that at the moment.
I mean, look, Nyx Slayer is kind of making a stink face right here, but most likely because of that Keeper of Oldemon that he wants to play out. But I think he's fine with just going for Noble Sacrifice, Avenge plus a Hero Power here. I mean, that's a pretty strong play, honestly, if you think about it. And looks like he's gonna pop open this egg, interestingly enough. Looks like he just wants to get this trade off before he can Power Overwhelming. Looks like a read that he's made. And gonna buff up.
I kind of like this.
I do.
It's not a play that I considered, I'm willing to admit, but as you said, he had the Keeper in hand, which was the curve play. And getting it out of his hand here, he has a good chance of improving the stats of his Shredder drop. And that egg against Zoo is gonna get value at some point.
Right.
So you're making him get no value out of the first half, taking a favorable trade into the second half. So in terms of the long game of the eventual value that egg is gonna get, you actually come out quite a long way ahead in that exchange.
Yeah, it's something you see sometimes in the olden days when it was Zoo versus Zoo. Sometimes you saw if you played a Flight Mimp and your opponent coined into egg, you sometimes just killed the egg because otherwise it was a disaster, right? So
yeah,
looks like we have that Soulfire coming out of the Dark Peddler and the knife hitting face, which is not the plays right now, unfortunately. Bunnyhopper probably, is he going to clear off one of these minions? It might be pretty bad if he does so.
Yeah, I think he used the first imp there to test for Noble Sack before he invested the Power Overwhelming attack, but now he's going to get the sad news that this is an Avenge, and I don't believe he has enough power left to deal with it. No, he doesn't.
Challenge is going to be brutal here as well. Having a 6-5 down, getting all those secrets, you're 6-6, but not only that, 6-5 can generate 2 hero powers as long as it sticks around, and that could be pretty powerful, going in a game where you're fighting for board all the time, getting 2 1-1s down might give you a little bit more leverage than you would normally have available to you.
Yeah, Nyx Slayer's probably just thinking about what kind of attack he wants to make. Unfortunately, this Fire Elemental Garrison Commander is probably going to have to go into that Knife Juggler because it's too dangerous.
Yeah, I mean, again, your eyes light up. You want to start pressuring the Warlock's hero, the Warlock's life total, because you know they spend so much of their resources life tapping. The more life you allow them to have over the long term, the more resources they can gather. But Knife Juggler is just one of those minions. It's on a short checklist of minions that you just have to kill. Alongside things like Sorcerer's Apprentice, Manaworm, Tunnel Trog, etc. They just have to die.
Absolutely. We have the full Christmas tree in play right here. It's so beautiful. Unless you're the opponent, unless you're Bunny Hopper right now, but
wasn't it you just a second ago that was saying that Paladins shouldn't win games anymore? And now we're just evangelizing about the beauty of the Christmas tree.
I don't know. Sometimes you just gotta root for it, you know.
Okay, but
beauty's not the word I would use. But revenge goes on him as well.
Oh, that is pretty huge.
So this guy is again still gonna stick around unless he can clear it, maybe with a Soulfire. Yeah, that Soulfire is so clean here.
It's really nice. It really, really is. Yeah.
This is actually really nice for Bunny Hopper. He gets to play the Inkgam boss as well.
Dream knife to the 2-1. Oh.
Okay, so I at first glance, you obviously want to spread out your power and you want to have the minion with the less health get buffed up a bit. Yep. Obviously, we can see the Peddler and the Imp trade in right now if Bunny Hopper wants to, but would it have been better if it went on the Mysterious Challenger? Maybe it would have.
So it would have ended up with 8 total health.
Right.
But it still could have been. It's a very similar situation in terms of what you have to trade in Soulfire. It's just those attacks are now split up in different directions, but you're still dealing with the same amount of total health either way. So I'm not entirely sure.
You know, Nick Slay's Mysterious Challenger didn't have as much impact as a challenger usually would. I think Bunny Hopper had nice answers. That Soulfire was definitely a great pickup from the Dark Peddler previously, but he is staring down a 7-7. That is a big threat, and this can now leverage some life. But Knife Juggler's there, which we talked about, which is one of those minions you just need to get rid of.
Right, and on top of the Soulfire pickup from the Peddler, the Imp Gang boss off the top was also huge just because it filled the curve so perfectly, allowed him to be proactive, have the perfect one mana remaining for that Soulfire for tempo and discarding no cards.
Exactly. And this game is kind of just showcasing the strengths of both of these decks, right? Because you see the Mysterious Challenger come out, so hard to deal with it, but one of the decks that's actually pretty good to deal with it, and one, I mean, among decks that don't really have Big Game Hunter is Zoo, because they typically have a decent board size when it does come out. So you're seeing Bunny Hopper dealing with it as best as he can, but still facing a really big board here.
Yeah, definitely an intimidating board state. Voidwalker is one of the better early game cards to draw in the late game, I think, as Zoo, just because it does still function as a delaying method, as tall minions tend to do. So, and Imp Gang boss you're almost always happy to see. So he's tapping into reasonable stuff right now, but he is definitely a little bit overmatched on the board in terms of power. But he does have some nice trades available to him, especially since the Knife Juggler is going to help fire at least 3 knives this turn.
Actually, I was getting so confused here about because I always think there's a Knife Juggler on the side.
Oh, that hit the right target as well, so Peddler can actually clear that up nicely. So he can clear that with the Peddler, drop another Imp Gang boss, another nuisance for Nick Slay. And I know the thing is, the 7-7 is kind of still free to do what it wants, unless he clears it.
I think there can be a clear here.
So he only has the Peddler and the Juggler left to attack now. So
Right, yeah.
Seems unlikely. Unfortunately, that he doesn't clear enough, so the Shredder can now just take out the 1-3 Taunt, and we can just have another issue of 7 to face if he would like it. It's where he directed that attack last turn. It's just, has his philosophy changed now, where he is scared of this board that the Zoo is generating, and Nick Slay is going to choose to use his 7-7 as a trading tool.
Right, let's just count it, I suppose, because on the side of Bunny Hopper, we have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 damage here. It's really hard to get, you know, Powerwhelming into Doomguard back to back to back. I think you have to just kind of play the greed game here and hit face.
Yeah, Mustafa Battle is an excellent tool to help you do that, because you get such a wonderful answer to that Knife Juggler, which is by far the most problematic minion on the board.
Right.
So I think that Muster Draw is huge to allow Nick Slay now the freedom of... Oh,
ooh, this is the
I think he might be one short.
And there's a Doomguard!
Wait, 5, I think he's...
No, that's it.
Is that it?
That's it. That's 15.
Oh,
it's 15.
My goodness.
Wow.
D2, you've cursed this game. Why would you say these things?
I am so sorry, Nick Slay. I am so sorry.
Nick Slay.
I am cursed him to this fate.
He's going to be so upset with you if he watches the VODs, right? He's going to be very upset with you. So Bunny Hopper clutches out a victory there with the Zoolock, taking a 2-1 lead. He is one game away from qualifying. That was just...
Nick Slay was just absolutely stunned if he saw his face there, and Bunny Hopper was like, well, sometimes it happens.
I have some advice, D2. Don't Don't talk to that guy anymore.
I mean, I've been kind of a curse on these players, I think. I sent out 3 BlizzCon qualifiers yesterday.
Right,
so
yeah, absolutely.
Nick Slay, I'm so sorry. Don't blame it on me.
Crazy finish, but obviously, you know, he left himself open to that punish, but, you know, you would be ridiculous to say that was a mistake. You know?
Right, I mean, killing an Imp-King boss in that situation.
Yeah, I mean, it's ludicrous. He could have prevented himself from dying that turn under any world. But the aggressive play is just obviously the correct one for the reasons that I discussed before. Right? You need to pressure their life total.
Yeah, and there's risk involved whether you go for something that turn or not. Like sometimes something that seems safe at the moment is risky in the future because you risk getting your board kind of overtaken later on in the game. So definitely, I feel like that was the right play. Unfortunately, the exact 2 cards came off there.
Yeah, and who doesn't want to put 7 to face, right? You just want to do it. It just feels so good. And it was unfortunate for Nick Slay there. It did look like he was in the driver's seat in that game. But, you know, sometimes you just draw the right card you need at that moment. And Bunny Hopper, just like you said, you're just like... and Nick Slay was just like,
sometimes
no!
You just get it, yeah.
No, it was probably it was more devastating for Nick Slay than it was great for Bunny Hopper, I guess, because he felt like he was in control. And, he put a lot of work into fighting for that board. But yeah, so Bunny Hopper is 1 game away from qualifying, you know, using the kind of unconventional Paladin, using Zoo. Is this going to be Zoo Druid? You know, keep consistency with the lineup?
I'm not quite sure that's a thing, but if anyone is going to bring it out, it's going to be this guy.
Well, Egg Druid is kind of a Zoo Druid.
Sure. Jackie Chan, of course, the inventor of Egg Druid, is in this tournament as well. Not sure if he's still scrapping away in loser's bracket. I believe he was still in going into day 2. But Bunny Hopper, as you said, just has his Druid left to win with up against the Paladin and Druid of Nick Slay.
Yeah, so Nick Slay is still in it because the Secret Paladin is a pretty favorable matchup against that Druid. And, you know, Druid versus Druid, anything can happen.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, so Nick Slay is not out. He does have some good matchups going forward. And a mirror, of course. And we've seen Druid mirrors so many times. It could just, like, tip in his favor, get the ramp he needs. I think if I was Nick Slay, although that was a devastating loss in that moment, I wouldn't be too bothered. I mean, I'd look at the lineup and go, you know. Bothered's not the word. I wouldn't be super upset. I would be like, just forget about that. Let's go into this next game and let's win. So it is going to be a Druid mirror.
This is surprising to me because I would have expected Nick Slay to scout out the deck with the more favorable matchup first.
That's a very, very good point. I think not everyone. I do agree with you, but I don't think everyone agrees with you that Paladin is favored against mid-range Druid. Mm. They have a lot of answers that can line up really well, especially if they get the early ramp into Keeper of the Grove. If they're playing additional cards like Living Roots in their deck, that can help out a lot too. And obviously, Swipe is just such a backbreaking card in the matchup. I personally agree with you. I think Secret Paladin is a little bit favored, but he may feel differently. He may feel like the 50-50 here he has with Druid is actually his best matchup.
You're talking about scouting cards. This might be an opportunity for Nick Slay, depending on how Bunny Hopper plays, to scout out a potential Harrison Jones. Maybe Bunny Hopper has it in his deck and he needs to play it on board because he has nothing else. That might be an opportunity to see that card and be prepared for it in the future.
Could be true. And we see these mulligans coming out here. Nick Slay still kind of agonizing over his. Bunny Hopper throws away that Keeper, obviously not a card you want in this matchup, but gets another piece of ramp here. Unless he gets some card draw or a big minion to kind of get the tempo early, this might be problematic for him.
This is one of those fairly ugly Darnassus Aspirant hands. It's made a lot better by that Living Roots, but generally Innovate and Aspirant aren't really 2 cards that you want to draw together without any other minions, in my opinion, anyway. I think
I feel like Living Roots makes it even worse.
See what you say, right.
Okay. It's not enough impact.
Sure, yeah. But I think overall this is one of those, you know, lots of mana, nothing to do with it situations that he has here. Whereas Nick Slay just has the completely solid coin wild growth into shade play.
Right, and probably going to see him go for just the Keeper on turn 4, or excuse me, on turn 3, if he doesn't pick up anything else, just because he wants to get back onto the board. Mm-hmm. And just seeing how this goes down, the shade's pretty nice, though.
Yeah, it's a nice. They both have nice curves going in, but I think Nick Slay had the better overall hand, having that wild growth, being able to play the shade first. And you were casting the game earlier today where you're talking about how to use a shade as a druid.
Yes.
There was a kind of a conflict of opinion. You could save it up, mm-hmm. or you can use it to trade. So, you know, we'll have to see how these guys use their shades to either leverage the board or just keep it there ready for the combo.
Okay, so...
Wow, wild growth. Bunny Hopper, I don't think he needs more mana.
No, I think we're good for mana here. Top deck Shredder would have obviously been fantastic there. That would have made that... Our whole discussion about, you know, Aspirant, Innovate, too much going on. It would have made it somewhat irrelevant because Shredder could have come down and filled out the curve, but As it is, he's just played a three-mana play here anyway. His Darnassus Aspirant is so far just functioning as a River Croc.
Yeah, I think that the getting the Shade here is fine. Not getting a 4-drop here is fine, but I think he really wanted to get something like a 5-drop potentially, or maybe even an Ancient of Lore that he could curve into potentially the following turn. Because right now, Bunny Hopper, I mean, it's one thing to have, you know, it's one thing to be relying on every single card off the top, and it's another to be like, okay, I just need one card in the next few in order to fill up my curve, and that's a big difference.
And the Shade is going to have to clear the Aspirant here. So he's revealed his Shade already, whereas Bunny Hopper has one hidden, so that might play to his... The Aspirant might have played to his advantage in the Shade
beginning.
Oh, that's horrible. But just to finish elaborating on your point, Nick, it's... I said, you know, his Aspirant is functioning as a River Croc right now. What it was doing that a River Croc doesn't is instilling fear in his opponent. A River Croc would not have had the respect to be killed by that Shade there, but Aspirant, you think, oh god, 5-drop next turn. But
once upon a time, River Croc did have that fear.
That's very true.
Helmmaster.
When it was about to get Coin Helmmastered and you lost the game because of it, that it had some respect back then.
All right, Wild Growth coming into the hand of Nick Slay, just to even things out a bit here. Nick Slay wasn't too happy to see the Wild Growth the prior turn, but if you could see it in the hand of Bunny Hopper, I think you would be a bit happier. Do you go for the Lothar here just for the biggest kind of, you know, biggest creature here, or do you go for the Azure Drake to give yourself more options? Has no spells in hand to affect the board as Nick Slay, so maybe he goes for the Azure Drake.
Yeah, Drake seems reasonable to me. It does offer up the free trade to the Shade.
I think you want that to happen,
yeah,
though.
Exactly. If the opponent wants to take it, but if that situation occurs, you feel pretty ecstatic about that, honestly. But he disagrees. He's going to go with the lower Feb here, take away the maximum amount of options from his opponent. If he does still choose to reveal the Shade, which he might feel...
Oh, right on time.
Never mind. I mean...
Right on time.
He does get the 6-drop, you know, he gets the Forest, but it doesn't really hit anything. I mean, hits the Savage Roar. That's the best thing, but you want it to hit minions. You want to be able to overwhelm the other druid with some bodies, but this is just going to get cleared up nicely by the lower Feb, and then he just replenishes both a Drake. You know, he's got another Shade in hand as well. So,
but I mean, even though it doesn't really hit anything important, it's kind of like Darnassus Aspirant Senior, where you really need to kill it, unless do something crazy. So, I think it's kind of nice in that situation to be able to kill, to be able to instill that fear. Otherwise, maybe Nick Slay hits face here. I guess Nick Slay is kind of low on health, so probably kills it anyway. But
and honestly, Nick Slay's consideration to play the 5-5 Lower Feb instead of the 4-4 Drake is probably just expecting the potential Emperor Thorazar. He wants that 5-5 just on board to trade going into turn 6.
Or Savage Roar.
The 6-mana turn, at least.
More situational stuff going to Bunny Hopper's hand. You know, he's got the Innovate there ready to drop the big end, but he never got to use it. Well, Innovate into combo, he can squeeze in extra damage maybe with a hero power, but overall, this hand just terrible.
He might be sitting around calculating how many turns he needs before that Shade just on its own is lethal.
Right.
With the double Savage Roar. But does anyone remember, I think it was Os Kaka's game in the actual World Championships last year where he drew Wild Growth, Innovate, Force of Nature, Swipe, but like every spell in the Druid deck. This is a very similar draw here from Bunny Hopper, just not really getting those proactive minions. But yeah, double Savage Roar with that Stealth Shade, kind of greedily building up its attack stat.
He's going to play Wild Growth so he can potentially get a kill the following turn.
Wow.
If he picks a Force of Nature.
Right, yes, because he'll have 11 mana total. Yeah, 11 mana total with the Innovate and 11 mana worth of Force of Nature Savage Roar combo. So,
Double combo by itself is 22 damage. With that Shade, it's well over 30, so.
And this is a situation where Bunny Hopper is making the best of his hand. He's making like a prediction in the future. Like, I can't do anything with this, but what could I do if I drew that card? And that's a sign of a very, really good player there. And Nick Slay just has all these options in his hand, but as soon as he saw that Wild Growth, he was just like, wait a minute, what's going on?
Yeah. Nick Slay's face right now is working out all the permutations. 22 is one of the alarm bell numbers that goes off in your head. If your opponent does something weird that puts you to 14 as Druid, you know what's happening. If your opponent does something weird that puts you to 22, you have your suspicions. So he's definitely trying to work out all the possible permutations here.
Right, well, 22 is double combo from nothing, but there's actually 22 from just this Shade here with the single combo. Mm-hmm. So I think Nick Slay might go for a heal here.
I think you have to. He's got no other real option. He's got no taunt, and he sees it as well.
Your opponent just Wild Growth hero powered.
Yep.
He's got something to kill
whatever
you.
Whatever turn
too.
This is. Yeah.
You need to deal with that. So this is Bunny Hopper's moment to find a win. Does he get it?
Force of Nature would be lethal.
Ooh,
how much damage is that?
Is that?
I don't think it's enough. There's not enough minions to pair with those Savage Roars.
Can he use it? Oh, yes, he can. So it's 10 plus 6 twice. So 22 damage.
23.
So good read there.
Does he have enough mana for
23?
No, he doesn't have mana for Hero Power as well.
All right, so 22.
Mm-hmm.
So Nick Slay's response to what he saw Bunny Hopper do previously and playing the heal saved him.
He was clearly playing around Drew the Claw double roar. I mean, that's...
Yeah, of course. Obviously, like we've said, he's had the God reads this set, right? So he's just gone, okay, like, I know. Not only do I know exactly what his hand is, I know he's going to top deck Druid of the Claw next
exactly.
turn.
But,
yeah.
Exactly. So what does Buddy Hopper do here, honestly? It's a really tough position for him. Does he go for taunt? Does he go for charge? I think he's just going to hit the face
fear factor, right? I have damage in hand. I'm going to go charge you. You have to deal with it.
Okay, so Savage Roar is not being cast. What do we take him down here to? His 22s again. Just seeing him back at that 22
Wait,
number.
How much damage is Savage Roar right here? Or
so
Nick Slay.
9, 11 plus 8, 19 damage, plus the hero power, 20 plus keeper?
Can't squeeze it in,
yeah, one too much mana. One damage and one mana off lethal.
Yeah,
I believe.
One damage or one mana off lethal here. So Nick Slay, pretty concerned. Hmm. The one thing for Nick Slay here is he knows he's dead to combo anyway.
Right.
So you just basically, maybe if your opponent picks up a Drew the Claw, some sort of crazy nonsense, he's probably thinking about all the stuff other than combo right now. That you know kills him,
mm-hmm.
So he's like thinking, okay, what can I possibly die to that's not combo? Because I'm already dead to that, so I don't want to die to something else, kind of stupidly in this situation. So he's thinking about all those situations, and he's gonna go with the most aggressive play here, I imagine.
Yeah, I think one of the first considerations on that list of things that you die to that aren't combo is double Savage Roar. That's one of the first things that you'll be thinking.
Oh, he's drawing.
So he's setting up his own combo for next turn. Like he's kind of going to go all in here. So Bunny Hopper, do you have
it? This is it.
He needs Force of Nature right here. Actually, second Drew of the Claw will be it as well. We already calculated that last turn.
Yeah, that's very true.
So yes, Drew of the Claw or Force of Nature here is lethal for Bunny Hopper. Has a 3 in however many cards he has chance.
That didn't look like it. It looked like Wrath. It is Wrath.
Oh. I don't think he has enough mana if he cycles here.
He has enough mana for one combo, which is enough.
Oh, right. He does, yeah.
So Force of Nature.
No! Now, Bunny Hopper was going all in on drawing very specific cards, and being able to like see that, knowing he needs to do that to win, was a good presence of mind from him. But unfortunately, he is not going to be able to close out this game, and Nick Slay is going to tie this up 2-2.
Yeah, Nick Slay, you saw Nick Slay's reaction. His heart just skipped a beat there.
Right.
Like, no. But yeah, sorry, you going?
Bunny Hopper was just going to show his hand there and say, you know, you knew I was sitting on something weird the whole game. Here's what it was, you know. It's like flipping your hold'em cards in poker. Just, oh, this is what I had, you know, making a point. But he's going to go on now 2-2 in the set. And it's going to come down to Druid versus Paladin, which is a matchup we discussed a little bit earlier.
Yeah, exactly. And we were talking about which one you think is favored or not. We didn't see a Harris in that game, but I'm just excited overall to see a game 5 between these two players. I've kind of repeated this ad nauseum to this point. You know, the pro players have kind of fallen down, but these players are really good at Hearthstone.
Right.
Yeah, it's been a good set so far. Both these players have been going back and forth. And now we're down to the final game. And when you're in a situation when you're going to qualify for something as big as a Winter's Championship, it's always great when it goes down to the last match because it's so tense. And I love it when these players have to kind of go all out to get these victories.
That game right there was just so tense, right? It's like, does he draw the Drew of the Claw? Does he draw that Force of Nature? We were on the edge of our seats looking at that. Obviously, Nick Slay was as well as Bunny Hopper.
Absolutely. And if it isn't crystal clear, this is 2-2 in the series. And this is top 8 winner's side with top 4 of winner's side progressing through to the Winter's Championship for the EU region. So this game right here is for all the marbles.
This is a career changer for both these players. You know, I've never heard of them personally, but now they're known. They've got like tens of thousands of people watching them. They're going to be going to the biggest Hearthstone event of this year, which will be the Winter's Championship. So this is a huge moment for them. I know they're in winners. They have an opportunity after, but you want to get through now. So yeah, this is it. The last game of this series. Who will go through to the Winter's Championship?
Bunny Hopper again, staring at a hand of four spells. I'm sure I play minions in this deck.
Nice. Yeah, definitely not what you want to see as far as the Force of Nature Savage Roar is concerned, but the Wrath is pretty good in this matchup.
It's okay. It's kind of in the early game, its only clean target is Knife Juggler. Mm. Doesn't interact that well with a Haunted Creeper, doesn't interact that well with a Shielded Minibot.
Shredder.
Sure, that's a very good point. But
Do you value ramp more over a Wrath at this point? That's what you got to think about.
Innovate is huge. I would definitely rather have Living Roots than a Wrath in my opening hand in this matchup as well. But I think with this hand, I think keeping one Wrath definitely seems very solid.
Yeah, I was thinking the same exact thing. Just keep one of those Wraths for emergency situations. Toss the other ones. If you see a Knife Juggler come on the board and you can't contest it for a long time, that could spell disaster. You take way too much damage in that situation. As for Nyxlay, I think he might just toss everything here unless he has a good reason to keep one of these cards with maybe Redemption if he feels like he's going to get a good target on it.
He does keep a hold of the Wrath there, afraid of stuff like Knife Juggler, Shredder, and this hand looks pretty bad for Nyxlay.
Well, so he's got Secret Keeper.
It's fine. It's absolutely fine.
I love Nyxlay's reaction. He just, again, the stink face comes out, gets the Secret Keeper. Oh, okay, I guess.
I might be able to make a Yeti out of this.
The problem is the two secrets are Repentance and Competitive Spirit, which
that's
is
true.
Like almost the ones you never want to draw.
Right.
It's hard to find a situation where it's strong, whereas Repentance is a card that can sometimes be strong in this particular matchup. Not on turn two, not on turn three. You're talking turn five, turn seven. That's when you want to get it down.
Absolutely. And Bunny Hopper going for a bit of a greedy play here. He could have gone for the Coin Wrath into the Wild Growth the following turn. And now this Secret Keeper is going to get out of control just momentarily. And do you play? I guess you don't play the Repentance. It's not going to do anything soon.
The thing is, if you want to play a secret at this point, you're going to need to commit two secrets because you don't want to just get Wrathed, right? So you have to decide, is it worth playing Repentance at this point, or is it worth getting an additional buff on the Secret Keeper? And I do agree, Competitive Spirit is probably the one you go for. And then she becomes she becomes a Yeti. She evolves into a Yeti very soon.
Right. I just want to point out that in our little interview that we held with Nyxlay privately for a bit of information, he pointed out that he tended to take a little break from Hearthstone when he wasn't fond of the meta, and one of the examples he gave of that is when Undertaker was dominant. And now, suddenly, the tables have turned, and Undertaker looks quite inadequate compared to what's happening with this Secret Keeper right now.
Absolutely. And Nyxlay gets the Competitive Spirit off. Bunny Hopper went actually with the Cycle Wrath last turn, which is kind of interesting. I suppose nothing else to do, right? Doesn't want to make this, doesn't want to run into any sort of other secrets, like, for instance, the the get down into the event, which would make it even bigger. So right now, Nyxlay kind of has an interesting decision to make. I think he just goes for the Knife Juggler into Repentance, though.
I think you have to at this point. You don't want to play into Swipe. You know, you saw a Wrath for one. I mean, he went for the draw, but you could be thinking, all right, Bunny Hopper might have a Swipe here. He's setting it up, and then you can kind of foil that plan. And not only that, you know, you make the Secret Keeper just a little bit crazy. I think that's okay. You know, he hasn't got much in hand, you know. He wants to keep some resources.
I would like to for him to be a bit more kind of risky in this situation because you've drawn so many secrets. I think what he's thinking is that I might not be able to play out the Keeper of Ultima next turn, so that he wants to just, you know, okay, so this is what he was doing with the Knife Juggler. Okay. I saw you kind of pointing
there. Yeah, sorry. As soon as I saw the Repentance go off, I was like, okay, yeah, of course he wanted a 1-1 that turn. He was playing Repentance. He wants to use that 1-1 to trade into whatever minion is played, in this case, the Piloted Shredder. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that makes sense in the end. What I was thinking is that I felt like he needed to be greedy and hopefully he gets something off the top in order to help him out, you know, just instead of going for as many hero powers as possible.
What do you think of that? Just not popping up in the Shredder.
There is a Noble Sacrifice up, and Bunny Hopper knows it at this point. It could be Avenge, I suppose. Or Redemption, actually.
Yes, it could still be either of those. Yep.
This is a tough spot for Bunny Hopper. This Secret Keeper has gone out of control, and Nyxlay is putting on so much pressure on his health. And I looked at Bunny Hopper's hand originally. It was looking pretty nice. He had a Wild Growth. He had like nice stuff to play. But then the Secret Keeper with kind of the situational secret just made it just a crazy minion, which he can't deal with at this point.
Yeah, absolutely. Druid was one of the worst classes that got terrorized by the old Undertaker Hunter, just because they have no way to like scale up with their removal into a minion that grows this big that early. They basically only have Keeper of the Grove that can silence it back to its original form, but they have no clean removal for something that grows that out of control. And you can see right now that it's just continuing to do a ton of work for Nyxlay.
Do you hold the attack? Yeah, I like that.
So Bunny Hopper was testing for something like Avenge, and if it landed on one of the 1-1s, he could clear it out right then with his Shredder.
Yep.
And realizing that it wasn't that, he knows pretty much for sure that it's a Noble Sacrifice. So not right now, he's just going to hold it back, and hopefully his opponent plays into it.
There's a lot of interesting decisions to make this turn from Nyxlay. He has to work out what he wants to leave potentially isolated against the Noble Sacrifice. He needs to work out whether he wants to deal with that Darnassus Aspirant to prevent a 7-mana turn from Druid, which is often a powerful turn. And he needs to figure out how much he values just hitting him in the face when he's at 15 right now.
He's just going to go for that 5 damage to the face. Takes him back to 10. Dr. Boom coming up on 7. Nyxlay is just in such a comfortable situation, and Force of Nature is going to have to come down here just to clear something, right?
Yeah, he can clear two of these minions, I believe, if I'm not... Well, can he? Actually, hold on.
No, he has 6 power. No, he can only now... Whoa.
And the Secret Keeper
lives! He can only kill the Secret Keeper or the other two minions.
Or the other two. Yeah,
Konkama, sure. That is just devastating.
How all-in do you go here? I mean, it's only going to be a Keeper off the top, right? That's the only thing that stops this from, you know, being something that could get punished. Going to be so much damage. Nyxlay sitting there. He sees it. He's almost there. He's almost to the round of 8, almost to the Europe Championships. He can feel it. There's the concede. Wow. Nyxlay is moving on, coming back from down 2-1. An amazing series just now. Bunny Hopper's so close, but he has another chance.
Yeah, the journey is not yet over for Bunny Hopper. He takes a trip down into the lower bracket where there are a lot of strong players waiting for him, but he exhibited some strong play himself, so he's showing that he has as good a chance down there as anybody.
Guys, I'm getting nerd chills. I don't know if Artosis trademarked that, but that was an amazing series. Bunny
really
Hopper
great.
Played yeah. great. Nyxlay has some crazy next level reads. I mean, I want to see a highlight reel of all those reads that Nyxlay made. I'm getting goosebumps right now. That match was amazing.
Yeah, Nyxlay was rewarded for his clever play. You know, he was getting frustrated during the matches, but he kept his composure enough to not make any mistakes and make all the correct plays and get a victory and go to the top 8 at the Winter's Championship next month, which is a big moment for his career.
Right, and I think that's an interesting point because we saw him as a very expressive player. You used the term stink face a few times. But, you know, that's fine. If that's who you are naturally and you know, it's more awkward for you to keep that in than let it out, then sure, let those emotions out, but don't let them override your plays. Don't let them cloud your thinking. Do whatever feels natural, but continue to just play solid Hearthstone, and that's totally what he did. Hugely impressive plays, particularly with some of his reads.
I just love the mood swings, right? Okay, I got Secret Keeper. We're good. We're in business here.
Although he never seemed like he was super happy with anything. He was just like, yeah, it's pretty good.
Like I said, slight irony that the guy that was bemoaning the era of Undertaker ends up winning with that constantly growing Secret Keeper. So
yeah, that was way too much for him to deal with. But one Secret Keeper would have made a big difference in that game. But unfortunately for Bunny Hopper, that Secret Keeper just snowballed out of control, and he just couldn't deal with it. Stuck around the entire game from turn one to the end of the match.
It dealt the finishing blow right at the end there, right before Bunny Hopper conceded. Just 5 to the face once more. Once he realized there was no keeper in hand, I mean, he went for it, just went to the face, and ended up being the critical damage.
All right, guys, that was a fantastic game from those two players. Dan has an interview potentially with the winner, so we're going to throw it over to him, and he's going to find out what his thoughts are.
Wow, what a great series. Getting to see the conclusion of how that series went transpired was awesome, as we have yet another person going to the Winter Championship. I just want to go ahead and talk with them with a quick interview before we move on, because you know what? I mean, we've had a lot of qualifiers so far, but yet I think this one was one of the most exciting yet. So, Nyxlay, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you very clearly.
Awesome. How are you feeling right now? You're another person who's qualified for the Winter Finals.
Yeah, I'm very happy. I didn't expect this. Most of the people here in Berlin didn't even know who I am. So yeah, I think it was very unexpected for me and for you probably as well.
Well, it was a pleasant surprise. I think almost all these players have been pleasant surprises so far. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, more about yourself too? Because, you know, people in Berlin, you said, didn't even expect you to go through. So let's get some background info on who Nyxlay is.
Well, I started playing Hearthstone as soon as I could. I applied for a beta key, and well, I got one in December 2013. And from then on, I played. Sometimes I stopped for a short while, but I played pretty consistently. I didn't have great results until, December, probably. I had a few top 100 finishes, but nothing really noteworthy. And then I got a few good finishes, and I managed to qualify for the prelims. And, I had success here.
Can you tell me what changed? You know, you said December is when you started getting top 100. Was it any announcement for like 2016 of how the championship was going to be running, or was it something that specifically triggered you to start doing that?
Well, it wasn't a good reason I started doing that. Basically, I was studying food science, but I basically quit in September, so I had more time to play video games.
Sounds a lot like what my story was like, too, and I hope it's just as good of an ending, too. Congratulations, man. Can you talk very briefly also about how you prepared for this tournament, specifically with, you know, the casters you've been mentioning, how on point a lot of your reads were. Can you talk about your preparation and practice for this event?
Well, I was, when I qualified at the end of, basically January, I was already certain that I would bring Secret Paladin, Druid, and Zoo. I had a lot of success with Zoo. Both of my top 100 finishes were with it, and I was very confident in the deck, and I thought Secret Paladin and Druid were probably the second and third best deck for me. And then, well, I tried out different decks on the ladder, just seeing what I win with and what I, what I think is the best deck. And Patron Warrior performed very well, and it also performed well in the tournament. It got banned twice, and in the three games I played with it, I won three times.
Awesome, man. Congratulations on your very strong result, and we'll see you in the Winter Championships. Do you have any final words that you want to say before we let you go?
Well, I would like to thank my sponsors, my parents. I don't have a team yet. Maybe I will by the Winter Championship. So, yeah. See you soon, guys.
All right, we'll see you soon. Thanks to sponsors, no team. But hopefully that will change. Congratulations, Nick. You are the third person to go to the Winter Championships. We have one more quarterfinal that's going to be happening too, but we also want to remind you guys to stay engaged in the conversation as well by hashtagging HCT and tweeting at us at PlayHearthstone and Facebook.com/Hearthstone. That also reminds me of a quick bracket update for what's happening around. I know a lot of people are following another fellow person that was playing in Berlin. That was 6-0. He has actually fallen as well to Casper, let alone, of all people, as yesterday we saw. He was a player that was making impressions and yet again making another strong one by defeating a big player. Also, Jackie Chan has fallen in the lower bracket to Dolwido. And then we also have Sho dropping finally in the loser's bracket as well, which means all of them are out. I think that's all the established players that have a history and background of some sort. None of them are going to the top eight, unless I'm going to be corrected. If you want to follow on the bracket with us, type !! In the bracket to get a link to the Battlefy, and you can check out what's going on there. In the meantime, we're going to take a break and find out who will be player number 4 for the Winter Prelims. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.